Imagine you were offered tickets to go and see your favourite team playing in a major final. You'd really love to go, but the tickets are expensive and you're not really sure if you'll be able to afford them. Suppose you stayed at home and watched the game as it was broadcast on the TV. It was a good match, but ultimately your team loses to a last-minute goal. Unfortunate, but you say, at least I didn't spend all that money just to go and see the team lose. If you've ever said or thought something like this before, then you're assuming that your presence in the stadium would not have affected the outcome of the game. Maybe you're right, but in this video we're going to be exploring just how big an effect your mere presence in a room can have. Maybe if you had gone to that game, you would have witnessed your team lifting that trophy. At this point, you might be wondering, have I tuned into Shots in the Quark, or is this a sports channel? Don't worry, we're going to be talking about physics now. In fact, the scenario I just described is precisely the reason why one of the most important fields of modern physics had to be invented. Statistical mechanics. What is statistical mechanics? Statistical mechanics deals with physical systems containing vast number of particles, like a gas. To study something like a gas, instead of tracking each individual molecule, you consider the averages. There are two main reasons why we need statistical mechanics. First of all, we need statistical mechanics because it's too difficult to keep track of huge numbers of particles. Let's consider a system of two particles. Assuming Newton's laws hold, we can predict exactly how this system will behave if we know each particle's initial position and initial velocity. We can record this data by writing down three numbers to describe each particle's position and three numbers to describe each particle's velocity. For each particle then, we need six numbers to describe it. Since we have two particles in this system, we need 12 pieces of information in total. Now, it wouldn't be too difficult to record 12 numbers, stick them into Newton's laws, and work out how this system will behave at any point in its future. But what if we add more particles? For every particle we add to the system, we need to record an additional six numbers. Perhaps it might be possible to model fairly large systems with hundreds or thousands of particles, but we'd quickly become swamped if we tried to do this for any realistic system, like a container of gas. A gram of nitrogen gas, for example, contains over 10 to the 23 particles, meaning we'd have to record 6 times 10 to the 23 pieces of information to model it. That equates to around 10 to the 12 terabytes of data. To put that into perspective, a good computer hard drive these days can store around 1 terabyte of data. So to model a single gram of nitrogen gas, you need a trillion computers. To put it another way, it's estimated that the entire internet contains around 10 to the 11 terabytes of data. So to model a single gram of nitrogen gas, you'd need 10 internets. In other words, trying to model large systems using Newton's laws directly is completely hopeless. It gets worse than this though. Suppose that data storage was no obstacle and we could build a ginormous computer that could store and handle all the data we needed. Even if we did this, we still wouldn't be able to keep track of all those particles. This is because of something called the sensitivity to initial conditions, and is the second reason we need statistical mechanics. When you're storing data on a computer, you can't specify real numbers with perfect precision. Let's say that we wanted to record the initial positions and velocities of all the particles in our gas. When we enter them into the computer, we can't specify them to an infinite number of decimal places. We just choose, say, 7 significant figures, for example. What this means, though, is that you're throwing away some information, and it turns out that your simulation of the gas will very quickly become completely inaccurate. Sorry to interrupt the video, but hopefully you've noticed a substantial improvement in production quality here at Shots in the Quark. This is all thanks to these guys next to me. It takes a lot of time, effort, and resources from all of us to produce a single video. We love making these videos, and if you'd like to see more like this one, please consider supporting us via our new Patreon. Your support will help us to dedicate more time to improving both the quality and quantity of these videos. And if you do, you'll get access to extra behind-the-scenes content, see upcoming scripts early, and more. So thank you very much for your support. Back to the video. We're going to demonstrate just how sensitive systems are to their initial conditions with a little calculation. Let's suppose that we have a pool table with some billiard balls bouncing around on its frictionless surface in an otherwise empty room. If we had perfect knowledge of this system, we could in principle use Newton's laws to predict exactly how the balls on the table will collide with each other at every point in the future. In any real situation, we don't have perfect knowledge, but how much will that really affect our predictions? In other words, how sensitive is this system to its precise initial conditions? Let's suppose now that you step into the room. We didn't account for your presence in the room, but does it really make any noticeable difference? Surely we can just ignore you. Well, although you might not get close to touching the billiard balls, as an object with mass, you produce your own gravitational field. In principle then, in order to work out the future trajectories of the billiard balls, we need to take into account your gravitational pull on the billiard balls. But again, wouldn't it be safe to just completely ignore this? After all, no offense, your gravitational field is incredibly weak. Think about it. You can counteract the entire gravitational pull of a planet weighing 10 to the 24 kilograms simply by raising your hand. The gravitational pull that you exert on objects will be 10 to the 23 times weaker than this. In other words, completely negligible. Let's try calculating it anyway. If you weigh 80 kilograms and you're standing away from the pool table at a distance of 5 meters, then the pool balls on the table are going to accelerate towards you with an acceleration given by g times m over l squared, where g is the gravitational constant, m is your mass, and l is your distance from the table. Since g is so small, this ends up being around 10 to the minus 10 meters per second squared. That's pretty tiny. If we focus on one of the balls in particular and consider the deflection due to your gravitational pull, we find that it will be deflected by a distance delta x is equal to the acceleration a times the time squared in between collisions. If each collision takes on average around 1 second, then this means that the ball will be deflected by your gravitational pull by a distance, a measly distance, 10 to the minus 8 centimeters. Okay, these changes all seem to be ridiculously small. Perhaps that means we should take the hint that your mere presence in the room doesn't change very much. Well, wait one moment. Let's instead consider calculating the angular deflection of the billiard ball. This tells us how much the angle of its trajectory will have changed by. We can find the angular deflection of our ball by taking the deflection delta x and dividing it by the distance that the ball has travelled between collisions. Let's say that the ball travels 20 centimetres before it hits another ball. If we calculate this, we again find that the angular deflection is tiny. But notice now that this is going to affect the angle at which the ball emerges from the collision. After its collision, we find that the new angular deflection, delta theta nu, is going to be given by delta x, the distance deflection, divided by r, where r is the radius of the ball. Interestingly, we can rewrite this in terms of the old angular deflection as delta theta times l divided by r. What we've found is that after a collision, the new angular deflection is given in terms of the angular deflection before the collision times a factor L over R. And L over R here is greater than 1. That means that if we repeat this calculation and see what the angular deflection is after another collision, let's say delta theta 2, then this will be given in terms of the original angular deflection times a factor of L over R squared. So in other words, after every collision, the initial deflection caused by your presence in the room will be amplified by a factor L over R. So if we have n collisions in total, the total angular deflection delta theta n is going to be equal to the initial angular deflection delta theta times a factor L over R all to the power n. It doesn't require very difficult maths at this point to show that in order to end up with a sizable angular deflection, you only need around 10 collisions to occur. In other words, despite your pathetic gravitational attraction, if you just stand in a room, you will completely alter the trajectories of pool balls bouncing on a surface within about 10 collisions. This is why trying to keep track of individual particles in a system like a gas is a hopeless endeavor. Not only do you need to store 10 internets worth of data, but any inaccuracies in your recordings will very quickly amplify and ruin your ability to predict anything. This is why the field of statistical mechanics was invented, to deal with averaged quantities like pressure, temperature, and thermal energy, instead of trying to keep track of lots of particles. This is why we said at the beginning of the video that your mere presence at something like a sporting event could completely change its outcome. A football match, for example, is a lot like our pool table. Applying this calculation to that scenario, we could say that after around 10 kicks of the football, your gravitational pull from the stands may have completely altered the course of the game. Of course, you'll never know exactly how you affect the match, but you should never underestimate just how much influence you can have. Your mere presence can completely change the world around you. Thank you very much for watching, and I hope you enjoyed. Please like and subscribe for more shots in the quark.